So I'll just show you what I did with these posts. I stuck them halfway out, so it's about 4 feet out there. That would give a good room for the balcony. I'd expand those holes for it to go through. I'll show you what I had in mind for the interior of this, with the supports and everything. So I just notched out just a little bit of area there for another pole to give it the support. And at the same time, this support is going to give support for all of the floor joists up above. So it'll give that extra support. I'm going to secure it here as well for that beam. And then for the rest of this support board here, I was going to put another pole on the other side. So it's not just held on and supported by those screws I put in there. So that's kind of a no-no for, you know, building decks or anything that you want to support. I mean, it's probably no big deal for a shed or something like that. But if it's anything that you really want to live up there and support your weight and support the weight of multiple people, then certainly screws are not going to just work for that. So I knew I needed to get at least a couple posts under there. So that's how I decided to do that. And keep pushing away on this. It gets discouraging, honestly, but because I run into things I have no clue what to do about, and I just have to take time to think about it. Now I'm working on the wiring in the shop shed thing, and I was going to use the extra 30 amp power that was going to my water heater in my house. Since I changed it to gas, I have an open 30 amp circuit, so I'm just going to run that. And I did a lot of research on what wire I need to do to work with here, and it is to run the 30 amp all the way out there. Basically, I just needed this the 10 gauge with the two wires in it, and then a ground is included in that. So that's what those numbers mean. I didn't really know that before, so I had to figure out the 10 gauge is the thickness of the wire, and so that the 30 amp is good for the 10 gauge. And then the smaller gauge is the 14 smaller gauge with the two wires, with the ground included in there. So the 14 gauge is going to be all for the interior light switches, plugs, and lights, stuff like that. Okay, I honestly can't wait until this is wired in, because this is going to give this shed some lifeblood in it. And then from there, I could put on everything else, the drywall, and finish it up with flooring and all that stuff. So this is what's been hanging me up. It's been taking a while, and I needed to figure out exactly how to do this. I bought a box for, it's basically just a used sub panel. And so I bought this at the Habitat for Humanity, and it was $5, and I had a couple switches in there, but I needed the one with, so basically 30 amps are going to come into this, the wire from the house, and the 30 amps was going to be split up into two, 15 and 15. So I had the option of doing this double switch breaker. And so then I have an extra open circuit there if I wanted to add something else later. But normally it would just be two 15s or whatever it is individually. But this will work just the same. And so I'll have that in there, and then I don't have it wired for 20 amps yet. I don't know if I'll do that or not, but those are options. So that's pretty much it. And then after I get this in there, the power running into it, then all my power going out to the plugs and switches and everything, I could figure out which outlets and stuff I want on each side, on the 15 amp and then the other 15. So we'll figure out exactly how to set this up. And basically I have imagined in my mind the setup here, and I had to really figure this out as well. Kitchen area with a sink will be the temporary sink anyway, the temporary kitchen area. It's going to be sitting right there, and so I'll need some power for at least a microwave, toaster oven, stuff like that. It's going to take up the 15 amps, and then I'll have a little bit left for like lights or whatever. So I need that one on one circuit for the 15 amps. And then I thought of my window air conditioning, and that's going to take up the other 15 amps for that. So this is going to be basically just a small camper RV, and I'll have to keep in mind, you know, the appliances that I'm using. It's just going to be kind of basic running. But if I run more than those two on one of the 15, it's going to flip the switch. But this is the way I figured it out, so I can run a major thing on this 15 amp, and on the other circuit, I could run a microwave or the toaster oven on the other circuit. And then I just have to feel it out from there for what I use. And then I'll just have like a basic plug on each side, and then some basic lights coming running. So that's what I had to imagine. I had to plan ahead for that and figure out what I wanted so I can figure out the wiring after that. So now that I've kind of figured it out, I can go forward with this, hopefully have something to show for it today. So I'll just be quite frank with you. This was probably the most intimidating part of all of this, and the thing that is holding me up from everything else. And I just methodically thought through it, watched a bunch of videos, tried to get, even if I didn't understand what they were saying, I just tried to, you know, soak in as much as I could. I went to the either Menards or Habitat for Humanity. There's somebody there handy who knows something about something, even if it's kind of basic stuff. And all I wanted to know was the basic stuff, so I'm not, you know, causing a fire or killing myself. So if I knew, you know, the basics like that, I mean, a lot of it's common sense too. Shut the power off, you know, just, I have a multimeter to check, you know, if there's power running through any wires, and then knowing amperage and thickness of wire to know what it could handle, because if it overheat and bursts, you know, causes a fire, then it's just those things, you know. I figured out, you know, those types of things, and I run it across them and say, you know, I'm doing this, what do you think? And then they confirm, yeah, that'll be right, it should work out. So then you kind of get some confidence of what you're up against, and then you kind of narrow it down. And, you know, all these numbers on the wire, you know, I just didn't really understand what they were saying. And I kind of narrowed it down what they were saying about it, thickness of the wire, and then there's two wires in there, plus a ground. So there's really three wires, but they just count the two that you're worried about. And so, and then in other wires, they have a different number for different thickness, or they have more wires in the thing. So after I kind of narrowed that down, I'm like, okay, well, I know what that is. And then I know what amps, I looked up what amps that the 14 gauge can handle. It's up to 15 amps. And then this is some 12 wire, the gauge. 12 gauge is the next step thicker than that. And this one could handle 20 amps, sorry. And then the next gauge up was the 10 gauge that I had, the orange stuff, and that could handle 30 amps. And that's why I'm using that for the 30 amp circuit that's free from my old water heater. So I knew that those wires could handle, and then just all the interior stuff is just going to be for those 15 amp breakers that for all those switches and lights and stuff. So, and I knew that I just needed these boxes. I've seen these before. You mount them up in the wall and a nail or a screw, put it in there. And I did learn that since these are metal boxes, they do have plastic ones. But I, you know, these were available at 25 cents each, so that you do have to ground the wire before you put it on the green ground on the plug. So you put a screw right in there as the wire feeds through there, the ground wire, and then it continues. The ground wire continues to plug into to hook onto that. So that's one little detail that I learned about this, and that was good that I stumbled across that information. So then I kind of narrowed it down from there of like how to pigtail some wires in case one's going to go to another switch or a plug or another line out to a plug of power. And so I bought some of these. And then these are just holders for the wire so it doesn't yank out of there. So those are just the things I just kind of narrowed down in my mind. Because looking on the shelf, I just saw a bunch of this crap, and I'm just like, I don't know where to start with that. So I looked at the shelf for an hour and just... So those are the realities of what goes on of that. I just wanted to include that in the video because it just looks like, you know, I jumped into this not doing very much research or anything, or it may look like I know what I'm doing, but I really don't. And this is just a new frontier for me. I've done a little bit of this in a camper trailer, but not much. So, and in the future, I do want to have a capability of hooking up DC power to this. So I want to think ahead and I want to have a battery, at least one battery, one or two, kind of like an RV, you know, it's got one or two batteries that you could charge up, and then having maybe a plug and a row of lights or something that runs off of that battery. And so if the power shuts down, something happens with the on the grid stuff, then I have, you know, I just plug into the DC power and I still have lights that I can run off batteries. So I do want that backup system. So I need to, before I put the walls in, I want to at least have like a DC battery hookup. And that should be pretty simple to do. That's not that hard. So, okay, so I think I've said pretty much everything that's on my mind right now. I'll see how far I can get. So I need to point out this light here, and I needed to figure out how to mount this thing on there, because this is a pretty heavy light. It's got this at a university surplus store. It's like a outside utility light. So since the design of my paneling there, I have about an inch gap between the paneling and the outer OSB wall. I need to fill that in, so I actually screwed in. You can see in there, I screwed in a 1-inch square piece of wood there, and that's where I'll mount this so it has enough rigidity, I guess. It's because this is a heavy light, so. And it's pretty wide, so I need to just show you real quick. So it's gonna go here, and I need to take care of the gap between right here where it mounts. So I'll probably put a piece of plastic or a piece of wood there, a treated piece of wood, and then put some caulking around where it attaches there. So that's the way I figured it out. And so this is the mounting plate. It'll mount right there. And the piece of wood is behind there. So that treated piece of wood will bring it about right here. I'll screw that through to the other side, and then it'll just mount on this thing. I'll have to drill a hole in the middle for the core, for the wiring to go through. That's it. So I just wanted to detail that out for you. So since it's a little unique situation there. So for this mounting plate, I decided to use for the spacers, this plastic is for the my rain barrel. I just cut it into squares to the space I needed it. I wanted it to be waterproof and rigid, so I decided to do it that way. I do have some treated wood, but I just didn't want to use treated wood for that. But I'll just do that and put some caulking on the top and back there, so I have some good sealant. This is what it looks like as I finish it up and I screw it in right here. Just caulking in between, and I did a little rubber seal type thing on the end there. I just wanted to make sure this was sealed. Didn't want any water going through there. Well, that's what I had envisioned. I like the, I'm a big fan of just kind of like a warehouse utility look. It's just the man cave part of me. I don't know. It's all sealed up. All right, got the second utility light out there. Same process as the first one. And just temporarily put some posts up there for the law or the balcony thing. Just might use those posts for that. Not too picky with that, but I do have in mind, I did have a plan for double doors to open up, and I didn't do it this time. It's going to be a later project when I modify stuff, and it's going to have the ability to roll up my camper trailer or my cargo trailer up there, open the doors, and there will be the extended cargo space and whatever I need. Load things on, load things off, or you could even stay in this, put some beds in here, just have everything connected. Okay, I'm just going to do a quick update on this clip because it's been taking a long time for me to get back to this project and everything else during the summer. But I knew I wanted to get this all buttoned up before the winter and everything set up. So I left the project at a good point so I can get it buttoned up real quick. The last thing I needed to do was electricity, getting all the wiring done. And so I have my 60 amp But I'm only using 30 amps from the 30 amp from the house, and then it'll split off into the two 15s for each side of the house. So it'll be two circuits, 15 each. So pretty much like an RV camper type thing situation for the AC stuff. And then I'll put a DC power inverter somewhere for a battery bank and stuff like that. Just, and I'll stream that after the walls are up, and I'll just kind of do that. Also, I have a tank up here, which I might have shown this before, but this is an RV tank, old camper. I bought it for, I don't know, it's a 40-gallon or 37-gallon or whatever. But this is going to be my gravity-fed shower water, and or else, you know, drinking water or whatever. But it's going to have a rain shower head thing, and it'll just be gravity-fed, and I'm going to use my old shower in, or my temporary shower in the house that I made. It's been working great for me, so I'm just going to use that. I'm going to hold off on my temporary bathroom shower thing out there because I can't get this through the door, and it's, you know, I'd have to do my double door thing, and it's going to hold me back right now. So I just need to get my other temporary shower there, and then I'm going to do a composting bidet system, which will be amazing right here. And you are going to be blown away by that. This is all going to be, I'm not going to need any water pressure or anything. This is going to be room temperature water up there at all times, which will be comfortable enough for a shower, so I won't need hot, cold water. Won't need a propane water heater or anything. Honestly, this has been my experience through with my house and stuff. I haven't used hot water for really anything, even washing dishes. I don't really need hot water. Just use antibacterial or, you know, detergent soap or whatever. So that's all I've really used it for, but I don't really need it that much. And besides a comfortable shower. So, and even my showers, if they're about room temperature anyway, I mean, I'm comfortable enough. So I'm not picky about that. And so I felt like, you know, if it's up here, it's going to just keep the room temperature or whatever that is. And then plus, since it's up there, heat rises and it'll stay a little bit warmer than even down here. So if I have my, you know, house around like 65, 70 degrees or something, then that'll get about that plus a little bit more probably. So that's good, comfortable water temperature, and that'll last for a good while. I will have a pump pressurized system to get water up there and stuff, but that'll be reserve tank for that. So now I'm going to get to the insulation, bubble wrap for the ceiling, and then now I'm ready for the shiplap stuff. Found some wood at my granddad's house, and he's gonna give me, which has been a problem I'm trying to solve with this. I didn't want drywall because I wanted to be able to take off the planks and modify wires or put in something or repair something. It's just so convenient doing it that way, and I didn't want to worry about all the mudding and all that crap. So wiring's been pretty simple. I've just been two circuits and then plugs wherever I wanted them. So kind of planned ahead for what I'm going to use on each circuit. So that's pretty much it. I will get to it, and then I at least wanted to show you what I'm doing now so you know the state-of-the-art stuff I'm going to use. So one of the major things I needed to finish off the inside of the tiny house shed thing was to get interior either drywall or shiplap or something, and I was just debating all that stuff. It's always, you always got to pay money and have a table saw and everything, but a person in my church actually had this in their backyard and they're looking to get rid of it. So usually, you know, people sell the wood off of old structures like this, but you always find a building that's crushed, that's coming down, and people usually want to get rid of it. So
Sometimes it's word of mouth or online. Sometimes they just say, hey, just take what you need, and they don't charge anything. You have to look around for that. But this is a great blessing. I was actually praying about this the night before, that actually was able to get this, all the wood I want. So it's great. Got a lot of rustic qualities, little windows here and there. There's a lot of wood in there, so I don't know how much I'm going to be able to get out of here, but it's going to be quite a bit. It's going to save a lot of money though, at least a couple hundred bucks. So it looked like this is tongue and groove, so that'll go good for my wall. I didn't know that was tongue and groove. Got a rustic door here, double door. That's pretty cool. Kind of want to check this out before I get in there. I know this is like tipping over. But luckily, it's already pretty much on the ground. I mean, it doesn't have that far to go. At least I don't have to climb up very high to get anything. I got a little shed thing. Alright. Well, I could work with this. We'll see how much I can get off of here. So I've never had to make a judgment call on what is good, bad, or somewhat okay wood. I just it's pretty broken up, but the benefit from a rustic design is that you could be pretty sloppy about it and it still looks good. So a little bit of sanding and it's still going to be, this wood right here is a little thicker, so I might use some of this. But it's all just very crumbly in places. So I just have to kind of see the potential in it, cut off some of the bad parts. This is my first time really looking at like old wood like this, so I don't know. I don't know how to make a decision really, but I'll just get what I can. So this is kind of cool. It looked like copper. I think it's just painted green. Yeah, I'm probably not going to go in there. There's probably some cool things though. A lot of rusty stuff in there. It's just gonna fall apart. I know it's a good resource though. If I come back here, pick some things out, people love this kind of thing. Little gate thing there, metal gate. Hinges and latches and all that. Even an old door like that, people buy those things. Still has the hinges on there. People like to sand them up, make them look good, and just love that old stuff. This is some of the side paneling stuff that I got from my granddad. This is as much as he had. It's not going to be enough for the entire walls, all the walls, but it's going to be enough for probably half all the way around. So I'm going to do like whatever you call it, a paneling on the first third of the, from the floor up, and then this will be the rest of it on top. So it's really blessed to get this stuff because you pay quite a bit for that.
And I already put one panel on there just to see what it looks like. And it'll work out fine. I'm just going to clean it up a little bit and then stain it later. And use these little decorative nails. Put that all the way around. And then however far it goes, I'll just do whatever paneling. That'll make it a lot cheaper. So this is a quick peek of where I'm at right now. It's starting to take shape and kind of see what it's going to be looking like. So I will stain it eventually. And I'm trying to go as far as I can down with the amount of wood that I have. And then the rest of it will be the whatever you call it. That I can't think of the word. Something coating. And so I'll get that far, but yeah. It wasn't really all that difficult. I mean, once I got to this point, I just kind of traced out where the plugs are going to be, switches, and I can't really go wrong with it because of the, I mean, even if chips are out of this board, it looks fine. I think about a good point now. I started cleaning up around here. It's inspiring just to clean up and then see where you're at. I've been trying to figure out my wiring and stuff. I got some electricity from the house. This is basically just a 30 amp from my water heater that was there in my house before for the electric water heater. And I have it going up into a 60 amp panel. Basically just have 30 amps I'm just going to be using. That's not really anything there, but so I'm working on electricity. That's the only frustrating part of this, is learning that, trying to be not stupid and figure it out at the same time. So but I'm just doing kind of the logical stuff right now.